excited. Today's a beautiful day. My mother's here visiting with my sister. God's good. A lot of other good things are happening. I'll share in due time. For now, let's just agree that he's good to us every day. I'll keep this short but sweet. A few weeks ago, Jody shared that she was reminded by God that he's the God of now. You know, we should forget about the past. Don't worry about the future. And then I think it was last week, Suzanne brought it up. So this past few days, I have been putting some thoughts together for the message that I'm going to preach on Wednesday night. And as I was going through all the things that I have written down, I came across this that I wrote on March 1st this year, and I want to read it to you. And this is the last thing that I said when I opened the service that day. And it says, "We have been given the victory. It is our in Christ Jesus. We know that what is promised to us by the Lord will come to pass. We do not have to wait. I was reminded earlier this week that our God is a God of now. Not of yesterday or tomorrow, but of now. The promises from God for our lives have been fulfilled, and the manifestation is coming now." Yes. To me, that's confirmation that he's talking to us. Yes. He's given us a message through all of you. So I want to encourage you to continue pressing on and be expectant. This morning as I was making breakfast, I was listening to some worship music, I was praising, and I was praying. I got this presence of the Holy Spirit that I haven't felt for a while. And I'm expecting that something good is going to happen. It's about to happen. Right now, in 5 minutes from now, it doesn't matter. All I know is that it's coming. So I just encourage you to do the same. Keep pressing on, believing, praise and worship, and the miracle is going to follow. With that, I open the floor for questions. Anyone has a prayer request, testimony that would like to share? Tim.
Yes, I would appreciate all your prayers that went up for a situation in Indiana. And the one thing we noticed that when we went over to the courthouse was that you could tell God went before us. When the peace of God there, and then when we got in the room, it's like the first thing that came to my mind was Daniel in the lion's den. Should have never gone in there first place, but when he was in there, you know, and the king was all nervous, and
title this morning. Announce freedom to all captives. Mm-hmm. The Spirit of God, the Master, is on me because God anointed me. He sent me to preach good news to the poor, heal the brokenhearted, announce freedom to all captives, pardon all prisoners. God sent me to announce the year of His grace, a celebration of God's destruction of our enemies, and to comfort all who mourn, to care for the needs of all who mourn in Zion, give them bouquets of roses instead of ashes, messages of joy instead of news of doom, a praising heart instead of a languid spirit, rename them oaks of righteousness planted by God to display His glory.
Yes.
Yes.
Right now, God has given you beauty for ashes,
yes,
joy,
yes,
for gloom. Whatever the world gives us, whatever the enemy tells us, whatever the doctor's reports are, He trades that. The moment,
yes,
we're given it, we just let it go to Him.
Yes.
And He gives,
yes,
us Himself.
Yes.
This is the year. This is the now. This,
yes,
is the life we live of grace.
Yes.
And our enemies have been destroyed. In Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Mike.
Yesterday, the Lord led me to go see a co-worker down in Red Oak who has been battling cancer for the last 3 years. The doctors, they can't finish it up. And as I was driving down there, asking and inquiring of the Lord, what shall I do? Just carry what I put in you, placed in you. I got in there, and when I walked in, he had the stature laying in his bed of someone whom you would see in World War II in the concentration camps, the skeletal remains of what once was a man, with cancerous nodules on his chest and things like that. And I was, in my flesh, I was overwhelmed, but in my spirit, I listened keenly into the Lord. And He assured me, says, there's nothing that is too hard for me.
That's right.
Right.
So that point in time, I walked in, there was nobody else there. I thought some of his family would have been there, which on the way down there, I thought, now if these people were in there, I'm going to have to kick them out of the room. So I just walked in, I had my anointing oil. I know there's nothing in the oil that just represents the Holy Spirit, the Spirit that is within me, to preach the good news, as Suzanne was just saying, to bring healing,
yes,
to bring healing upon,
yeah,
this body, this carcass of a man that in man's eyes only has a few days to live, but with God, this can all change around. So just stand with me in faith, believing in His healing of the testimony.
Yes.
He is also a co-worker of Tony, whom we prayed for, who had a stroke about a year and a half ago, who is just about totally restored, working for many months now and is doing very well. And I know that Thursday night when I walked in there was a customer, Ryan, who also is Tony's friend. Him and his wife stood there and watched and let me minister to Tony. And that night, God touched Tony's life because there was a transformation from that point on. He is now being restored. He is, they gave him his license back. He's able to drive and everything again. So God turned that around. And then just stand with me so this will turn around for Mike also.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
jazz band last night. It was great. And I, we were worried. And to get up that early, I really don't even like to play that early. And it was just great. And they're becoming cheese. And was, maybe it felt like it was taking a nasty plunge, but still good enough to propel that jazz band to new heights. So it's good. I mean, you know, I guess as long as you don't get any lumps in the woods, are always there.
Yes.
This is going to be a bilingual session now, so I'll translate this as I go. Okay, so this is something that my mother wants to share. It says in here, my testimony is that I believed and I believe in the promise of the Lord. That if I believe in Him, I will be saved, me and my household.
Yes.
This that I'm seeing today is the greatest victory that my son Roberto, regardless of the circumstances, continues firm in the Lord, praising and serving Him with passion.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody, for taking him in and for loving him. I love you all for taking care of my precious child. Blessings for this house, your pastor, and everybody else.
Hallelujah.
Diagnosed with cancer this week. Just prayers. I'm not sure what stage, what she's doing yet, but the Lord, her attitude's 100%. God can heal me, so we're just standing in faith, believing with her.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Peter.
Oh, it's the same thing.
Okay. Yes, Connie.
This week we signed our boys up for soccer. Got there for the first practice, and it is church sponsored. When they have a game in between, they get a Bible story, prayer, and each one of these teenage coaches has to give a testimony, a different one at the different games. Praise the Lord.
Stand. Let's thank the Lord this morning for bringing us here together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us here to your presence today. Presence, Lord, that we know that is being poured over us to give us your grace, to give us your Holy Spirit so we can go out into this world and do great and mighty things because of the Spirit that dwells.
Thank you.
Toby touched it.
He
just touched it.
He did.
Toby's down working on the air conditioner, and I just saw the manifestation.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, Toby. Come on up.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm just going to wait. I was reminded over in the Middle East and over in Africa, places that are 100, 105 degrees. They're running air from 80 to 95 to 100% humidity. They got their praise on. Y'all got your praise on?
Yeah.
I heard half of y'all got your praise on?
Yeah.
All right.
Be thou my
riches, up one slide.
Riches I need not, no man's empty praise.
Praise him for the things he's still done. Hallelujah, Lord. It's okay. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, church. Let's worship him. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name. Worthy, 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 worthy. Woo! Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Now I know for sure where Toby helped me get that loose steeple off the church up there, because it'd be rolling down right now in somebody's car out here. Yeah, it's going to get restored and it's going to be put back up. We just need to get into the 21st century on the materials. And it was nice back in its day when they built it, but it was getting pretty soft and it was going like this in the wind. So, yes, the cross will be back up on top. It will rise. Nothing is taking its place. King is still on his throne. And even though the steeple's off the rooftop right now, it's still in our hearts. The kingdom's within us. He is the King. He is the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Glory, 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 glory. Y'all feel his glory, church? Woo! How many have been delivered? Been delivered? Y'all been delivered? Hallelujah, Lord! You get your praise on. When we see these little kids driving around their bikes outside the church building and stuff like that, there's a whole nother generation. Right, Jamie? Yep. She says right, yeah. I don't know where she's at, but I'm sure she's in the complex. Is she downstairs? She hears us. Bring it on, Jamie. Get that kids ministry, because they're coming. They're coming. They're coming. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah, because I've been delivered. Yes, I've been delivered. Oh, the hold the devil thought he had on me. No, he ain't got no more, because I've been delivered. I've been delivered. I've been delivered by the hand of the Lord. I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
Oh, the devil
hang
on me.
He ain't got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered by the hand of the Lord.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered. I've been delivered.
The devil
had
on me.
No, he ain't got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've
in a hopeless life. I testify to you, I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
The whole the devil had on me.
He ain't got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered by the hand of the Lord. Someone I know that's close to death.
Yes.
He gave a boy with asthma back his breath. But the greatest miracle to see is from sin he set you free. Jesus set you free. You are free indeed. I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
And the whole devil had on me.
Got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered
by the hand of the Lord.
I'm so glad. I'm so glad. Jesus lived in me.
I'm so glad.
Jesus lived in me.
I'm so glad.
Jesus lived in me, singing glory,
hallelujah.
Jesus lived in me, well, saints have me bound. But Jesus set me free,
Satan had me bound.
Jesus set me free,
Satan had me bound.
Jesus set me free, singing glory,
hallelujah.
Jesus set me free, I will. So glad
Jesus lifted me,
yes, I'm so glad
Jesus lifted me,
well,
I'm so glad
Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me, I've been delivered,
I've been delivered,
the whole devil had on me.
No more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered by the hand of the Lord.
Oh, I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been
delivered.
I've been delivered. The hold the devil had on me.
No,
he ain't got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered
by the hand of the Lord.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
Hold the devil
hand on me. He ain't got no more.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered.
I've been delivered
by the hand of the Lord.
I've been delivered. King of kings, and you are the Lord of lords.
Gather around your throne and around your throne there.
is our
King. 2, 3. You are
holy. You are holy. You are holy. Is our none like you, Lord, worshiping at your feet. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb who slain. Your kingdom has come to your people. Lord, rain upon your people, Lord, again. Let it rain upon your people, Lord, rain upon your people, Lord, rain upon your people, Lord, again. Let it rain. You are holy.
There's healing in your wings. Healing in your presence, Lord. We celebrate your presence, Lord. We celebrate your presence, Lord. We glorify your presence, Lord. We celebrate your goodness, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for what you've done and what you're doing right now, Lord. We thank you for your healing in this room right now, Lord. Your healing in this room right now, Lord. Even those who are watching across the internet, Lord, they're being touched and healed right now. Those who you have sent us to minister to, Lord, they are being touched and healed right now. Your kingdom come, your will be done. We celebrate, Lord, as David celebrated as the ark was coming back into Jerusalem after being in captivity by the Philistines, Lord. We celebrate. We want to sing of your goodness, of your presence. We want to sing, Lord. We want to thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Sing a song. Come on, church. Celebration, lift up a shout of praise, for the bridegroom will come, the glorious one, and all will look on his face, we'll go to a much better place. Dance with all your might, lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, when he will appear, and all will stand by his side, a strong, pure, spotless bride. And we will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join the song of the Lamb. Sing a song of celebration, lift up a shout of praise, for the bridegroom will come, glorious one, and all will look on his face, will go to a much better place.
Dance with all your might now.
Dance with all your might, lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, when he will appear, and all will stand by his side, a strong, bright. And we dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb.
We will dance.
We will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join by his side.
Jesus is coming again. Will say, Jesus is coming again.
Go get your bride, the wedding's today.
Jesus is coming again.
We will dance on the streets that are golden. The glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join. Song of the Lamb. We will dance on the streets that are golden. The glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb. Streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. Every tongue and tribe and nation
will join in the song of the Lamb. We'll join.
Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. God is good. Hallelujah. Excited about our visitors. Amen. We're so grateful to have Roberto's family here, part of his family at least, here with us today. And over the next few weeks, they're going to be kind of traveling around the states a little bit. But it's great to have them here. We look forward to meeting them, and we're just really excited for Roberto and for us too. We're just really blessed to have you all with us. And by the way, he's a biggest blessing as we are to him, he is to us. Believe me, he has really meant a lot to us, all of us. So thanks, Mom. You did a good job. Praise the Lord. Amen. And also, Darlene and Don are still here. Praise the Lord. We're just grateful to see them. Amen. From not quite so far away, but Phoenix might as well be another country as far as I'm concerned. I don't get a chance to get there that often, but it's great to have them back. We got to spend a little bit of time with them the other night, and hopefully we'll be able to do that again before they fly the coop and head south again. But we love and appreciate them so much. They've been such a blessing to this church, and to Sally and I personally, they've been just really good friends, and we just can't say enough good things about them. Praise the Lord. So we're grateful that they're here. We also have a pastor with us today, amen, sitting right there with Ron and Diana, and I can't remember his name, I beg your pardon for that, but
Ray Block.
Ray Block, all right, give Ray a hand, amen. Praise the Lord. Thanks, Ray, for your service to the Lord and to his people. God bless you, and just let the Lord continue to bless you. Hallelujah. I appreciate it.
Can I just say one thing?
Please do.
No,
that's fine.
You know, during the worship, I want to thank God for that worship.
Yes.
I really do. I tell you, brother, my wife and I, physically, my wife fell a couple times, broke some bones in her back, and has had a terrible time trying to get back on her feet and walk again. And so it's been hard for us to be regular, you know, but I miss that kind of worship. So my son came over, I said, you babysit, not really.
Yeah.
You mom sit.
Yeah.
I'm going to go down and worship the Lord.
Well, praise the Lord.
I tell you, it was wonderful.
Yes, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Ray. I appreciate that. And we really do feel like the Lord has blessed us. Small church, but you know, God is not limited to our numbers or anything else. He can show up big and any way he wants, and we're just glad to have him. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And It doesn't happen by accident. There's an anointing that comes with that worship, but there's hard work that goes along with that as well. And so we really appreciate our worship team. And we appreciate all of you for joining in and lifting up the Lord. Whenever we magnify the Lord, we get blessed. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Let's give him another hand clap. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. God is good. The Sunday school kids, you can go downstairs. And the rest of you have to stay here. Praise the Lord. You should make your break right now. You're stuck for them. But God is so good. And I just wanted to mention, a lot of you know, but some of you haven't got firsthand. But Sally and I are going to take a couple weeks off. And fortunately, we have a son and my oldest daughter, son-in-law and oldest daughter, have a place on the lake down at Lake of the Ozarks. So they're coming and going from there, but they won't be there for the next couple of weeks, so we get it, praise the Lord. So we're going to just go down and hang out and fish a little, and I'm sure Sally will have plenty of things for me to do. She is an order giver, praise the Lord, but she's a good wife, hallelujah. She's not here because she's home checking out her lists. She's got lists for everything, and I'm one of these kind of spontaneous, just grab a cleanest dirty shirt and out the door I go.
Yeah.
Not her. She's making lists of everything and wanting me to contribute. And I said, when I get home, I'll give you a list. Praise the Lord. She'll be happy. But she is a trip, and I thank the Lord for her. But she's not like stressful. She's a carrier. I say she doesn't get stressed. She's a carrier. Carrier. Okay. Well, praise the Lord. So this week we've been busy doing all kinds of trying to get stuff done. We stained the deck and I power washed the soffit. Toby inspired me from y'all last week, and so I got a shower for about 8 hours doing that. But we got it all cleaned up, and so yesterday I cut the grass, and normally Sally doesn't let me weed or get near the gardens because I don't know anything about plants. I know trees, when they get rotten, I cut them down, or else I cut limbs off, and that's all I know. And she'll usually come and tell me that's enough. Don't go any further with that. So I said, well, you know, I'd help you out here. I mean, I'm done moving the lumber, the limbs and stuff that I had cut down earlier, and I took them to the back of the property where we burn it. And I said, I'd help you with the weeding, but I said, I don't know the difference between a valuable plant and a weed. So she gave me the sage advice that, if it comes out of the ground real easy, it's a valuable plant. So I know the difference, but I it's a little late when the garden's all laying in the burn pile, you know. So apparently I won't be doing a lot of weeding for her. But God's good, isn't he?
Yes.
Amen. And it's so interesting, that last song that we sang is just incredible. Total keeping with what the Lord had kind of laid on my heart for this service today. I remember, I was thinking years ago when we were in a church in Texas. In fact, that's where I got saved and come to know the Lord. But I remember my pastor, it was a large church, and I remember him asking the congregation, how many of you know that you're saved? Know that you're saved. That if you die today, you're going to heaven. And there wasn't a whole lot of hands out of maybe 800 people or whatever was there that day, 600, whatever. Not a lot of people raised their hand. And it freaked him out, and it certainly freaked me out too, because I thought we should know if we're saved, we're saved. If we're not, we're not, right? But I know it really bothered him, because he wasn't a I come from a holiness church, and there was a lot of different teachings and things that are not necessarily heaven and hell, at least not in my opinion now, based on what the Word of God is. But we conform because that's the church we were in, and that's where we, were being raised up and taught and so forth. But the people were not secure in their salvation. And how can you have the joy of the Lord? How can you be at peace with God, and how can you have the rest that God promises us and that Jesus invites us to, and the peace that passes understanding, if you have no security in eternity, if it's still a question of what you're doing? And the big difference, the only real major difference between Christianity and every other religion. I think there's like 4,000 and some various religions. The difference between all of them, basically, it comes down to this: grace. Every other religion is an approach to try to reach God, to try to do enough to be accepted by God. Where with Christianity, it is God so loved the world that he gave, he came, he did.
Yes.
And we get the benefit of it. He became sin so that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ. Yes. It's all about God. It's all about Jesus. It's not so much about us. Whereas with other religions, it's all about your effort, your energy, your approach, your ability to do enough to get accepted or get, you know, blessed by God. And there's still no real security. You're just going to wake up one day and hope you're in the right place. Amen? But we have an anchor. For our soul, the Bible says, and it's Jesus Christ. He's the rock. He's the one that's made the difference. I want you to leave here today with a little bit lighter step. I want you to leave here today knowing that everything's okay, that God's got your back, your front, and your everything in between, praise the Lord. God has made a way for us to be at peace with him and with one another so that we can enjoy this life and experience it to the utmost, to the uttermost. Abundant life. That's what he wants us to have.
Yes.
And the only way you can have that is to be sure of your relationship with God.
Exactly.
Amen? Yeah. So let's start here with Psalms 96. Psalms 96, and we'll just read verses 10 and 11. The psalmist says, say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Now, that should make us a little nervous if we don't understand grace, because he's going to judge us with equity. In other words, everybody's going to get judged the same. That doesn't make me real comfortable. Amen. Because I know if God were to judge me based on my performance, and maybe measure me against, say, Diana or Ron or Toby, I might come up a little short. Certainly, if he measures me against his own righteousness and his own justice, I'm going to fail, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But look, here's the next verse is what just blows my mind. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar. And the fullness thereof. Hallelujah. Now, in a way, it looks like it's a contradiction, because on the one hand, he's going to judge everybody equally with equity. And then the very next response to that judgment that's coming is, get happy. Rejoice. Why? Because everybody's going to be judged by grace. I say, everybody say, no, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, you either accept that grace or you don't. Everybody's going to be judged the same way. Either you have accepted it or you have not. So those that have accepted, you've got something to be happy about. You've got something to rejoice about. Amen. All of creation is wanting to rejoice, amen, in this reality. We ought to be the first ones to do it. Praise the Lord. All right, let's go to 1 John now, chapter 4 and verses 17 and 18. 1 John 4, 17 and 18. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. And he that feareth is not made perfect in love. Praise the Lord. So there are people, a lot of people, I'm afraid, Christians, that get very nervous about the return of Christ. Now, we've been talking about this for 2,000 years. And I'm expecting he'll come back in my lifetime. Maybe. He doesn't. If he doesn't, that's okay. I'll still be with the Lord. But I do believe that we're in times. And so there's a lot of talk, and there, as there should be, about the return of the Lord. And people get nervous about it for the very reasons that I've already talked about, because of an insecurity. Yeah. Right. Amen? And saying to themselves, well, look, I may just barely squeak into heaven. Right? Now that stirs up anxiety, and it creates a restlessness rather than rest. Right? I mean, if you ever get a thought that, geez, what if I don't get in? I mean, what if I've done something? What if I don't understand this right? And, you know, that's the enemy. That's what the enemy does. He wants to get you into fear, amen, and torment, amen, that you don't have perfect security, that your eternity is not established, that it's going to be dependent on how perfectly you can live the rest of your life, amen? Yeah. Now, so what happens is then we get to the point where we can get anxious and uptight to where we don't even enjoy our relationship with the Lord because we see him as somebody that's going to judge me, somebody's going to just really be angry with me or upset with me or whatever it might be. So I'm telling you this morning that we can afford to relax about the final judgment. And I do mean relax. There should be no tenseness about it for us. There should be no anxiety about it. We ought to be able to just kick back and say, hallelujah, come in my lifetime or afterward. It's okay with me, whenever. It's all good between me and the Lord. Praise the Lord. So the scripture we just read in 1 John 4 says that we can have total confidence about the final judgment. You and me, as believers, you can have complete confidence about the final judgment. Amen? It says if we're fearful, it's only because we must be imagining some kind of punishment that we'd receive. Right? Look at verse 18 if you can again. 1 John 4, verse 18. There it is right there. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment, and he that feareth is not made perfect in love. So if you're fearful, then you just simply need to get a bigger dose of God's perfect love.
Yes.
You just need to understand God's love for you is greater than anything. Amen? And if you're a believer, you're secure. You can have security. You can have boldness on the day of judgment. Amen? You can just boldly walk right in and say, praise the Lord. It's great to be here. Hallelujah. I've been looking forward to it. You don't have to come backing in like a slug who doesn't work all week and then wants to get his paycheck and is feeling a little bit uptight about it, right? You can just walk right in, is what it says, and rejoice. If you've got fear, it's only because you haven't taken and received the perfect love of God in the way that he wants you to experience it.
Yes.
God is love, and he wants you to know that love. Praise the Lord. We're supposed to have total confidence, not fear, about Jesus' return. You know, people talking about hearing noises in the sky, and I don't know what's going on. I know that the enemy is the prince of the power of the air, so who knows what. But I do believe this. There's one horn I'm going to hear. I don't always hear the horns of the people driving around me. I just kind of tune them out sometimes. But I know one horn I'm going to hear, and it's going to be the one that we all leave with. Hallelujah. There's going to be a shout, hallelujah, and the ram's horn is going to blast, and we're going to be with the Lord. Praise God. And we're going to know it. Hallelujah. We don't have to sit around and worry about if I've got perfect hearing. Will I hear it? Is my life exactly the way it ought to be? And if it isn't, will I miss it? No. You have been made righteous and perfect in Christ. That's why you ought to love the Lord, and you ought to serve the Lord out of that love, not out of fear, not out of condemnation, not out of what might happen to me because I'm not perfect. He's perfect. And he has given us his perfection and taken our sins so that we can be reunited, reconnected, reconciled to God. And then he tells us, now go and be a reconciler. That means you gotta love people the way God loves you. You gotta forgive people. You gotta look past the crazies and the nutty stuff that they do, and just tell them how much Jesus loves them, how much God gave it for them, and that he wants to have relationship with them. And they can have it, even though they may have issues.
Yes.
Amen. Most of us in here are born again. I don't know everybody, but I'm assuming that we're all believers. Now, I'm not asking you to raise your hand because I already know the answer. But has anybody come short of the glory of God in the past week? I mean, I'm not saying you robbed a liquor store, but you might have thought about slapping your neighbor for letting his dog loose in your garden or something. I don't know. I mean, you know, we get just the thoughts. Jesus raised the bar so high that just to have a bad thought about a person is the same as murdering them. Right? Look at a woman and just the thought comes through your mind. Hey, you're guilty of adultery. And that works both ways. That's what Jesus said. Amen? So we're all, you may not be doing overtly horrible stuff, but we're, if you are or if you're not, the thought is enough. But Jesus paid the price for every thought and for every action so that we can rest. Labor, he said, to enter into my rest. You want to work at something? Work at accepting and receiving the love of God and the grace of God. And you'll be a better person to be around. Amen. It's attractive to people who are struggling to see people who, even when they have issues, they still love the Lord. They can still testify about the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. So let's look at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 28. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him, how many of you see, we're all looking for him, right? As many of unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. He's not coming back with sin to deal with. Not for those that are looking for him, not for us, not for the believers. He's coming back just strictly for salvation. When he comes back, he's coming back for the final, ultimate payment of salvation. We have a seal right now. The Holy Spirit that seals us, tells us that we are in Christ, right? He's coming back to complete the transaction. Amen? He's not coming back to deal with your sin anymore. He's already dealt with it. It's already been dealt with. He's coming back for your salvation, for the ultimate payment. Praise the Lord. All right, let's look at this. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Well, that just pretty much erased everything I've already said, hasn't it? I mean, look at it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Yeah. I mean, all of us are going to appear there. Every human being is going to appear there. Right? But unbelievers get one destiny, and believers get another. Yes. Praise the Lord. It's not supposed to be stressful for us at all. Amen? Were our sins not judged in Christ? Yes. This isn't supposed to be stressful for us. It's stressful for the unbeliever. Every human's going to be there. But the believers get one destiny, and the unbelievers get another. Now, here's what happens. I know I learned this over the years, and I suspect some of you were taught the same thing, that there are two judgments. There's a main judgment concerning heaven or hell. And then there's a second judgment for Christians at the what they call the Bema seat, which is a Greek word, judgment seat of Christ, a place of rewarding various rewards for believers. Anybody hear that? Heard about that? Praise the Lord. Well, here's the truth. The word Bema appears about a dozen times in the scripture. And just here's a few examples. It's used to describe Pilate's judgment seat in Matthew chapter 27:19. It's used to describe Herod's throne in Acts 12:21. It's also used to, in describing Caesar's judgment seat in Acts 25 and verse 10, as well as the judgment seat of Christ in 2 Corinthians 5 and 10. But it means simply the throne, the place of power and authority. Amen? So we're going to be at that throne.
Yes.
Not for us to be judged. Others will be judged there. But we're there to receive salvation. Amen? It's not a measuring stick where we're going to come before this bema seat and Jesus is going to say, okay, you did pretty good. This is what you get. You, not so much, so you're not going to get a whole lot. Praise the Lord. But here, given the true meaning of this, it's just his throne. And because it's his throne, it's the place of authority and power, right?
Right.
Amen? So it's not a second event. This bema thing that they talk about, it's not a separate event from the judgment. It's the same thing. It's the one judgment. It's not a separate place where we're going to get rewards. Look at Revelation chapter 21, verses 3 and 5. It's not a second event that's being held for Christians to judge us how much we get, what our rewards are, right? So this, well, let's look at this in Revelation 21, verse 3 and 5. Now remember, it's a throne, this bema seat of Christ. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. He that sat upon the throne, which is Christ, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Praise the Lord. So where's the part where God says, hey, Nate, you did some super great stuff on earth. Let me give you some extra loot that nobody else gets. Praise the Lord. Let me give you some perks that Roberto isn't getting. Now, Roberto and I happen to be standing there on the same ground for the same reason, by the same means. But somehow, we've got this interpretation that God's going to give me some stuff because I did something really good. I mean, this is hypothetical, obviously. And Roberto's going to get stiffed because he didn't do the same thing. Well, think about it for a minute and we'll move on. Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 20, and let's look at this. We won't read it all, but it's verses 1 through 16. Y'all are probably familiar with it anyway. It's the story of the man who sends out his servants to go get people to work in his field. Right? And he gets some in the morning and he says, look, I'm going to give you a penny. Which would have caused me some concern right off the bat all day for a penny. But nevertheless, whatever that penny amounted to, he was going to give them each the same amount of money. So he hires this group of people in the beginning. The kingdom of heaven is like unto a man in his household who went out early in the morning, hires laborers. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into the vineyard.
Right.
Now, if you can drop down to like around verse 13 or 14 or something, we'll wipe it out. Because what happens then is, okay, what happens is the people are out there working. Some of them work till noon. And the guy goes out and he sees there's still some more people hanging around the employment office. And he says, you go, if you want to work, get out to the field right now and start and you'll get a penny a day. So they did. Then about 6 o'clock at night, he sees there's some more guys just standing around the employment office. So he said, you guys want a job? Yeah. Go out to the field and get to work. Give you a penny a day. 9 o'clock, some more guys still hanging around out there. He says, get in there and go to work, and you'll get a penny a day. Now, the guys that have worked since 6 o'clock in the morning are getting a little aggravated. Because they're saying, wait a minute, it's not right. This guy came in and worked an hour, and he's getting a penny, and I've been here 12 hours, and I'm only getting a penny.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. But he answered one of them and said, friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst thou not agree for a penny? Did you agree to work for a penny in the first place? Take that that is thine and go thy way, and I'll give unto this last even as unto thee. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with my own? Is thine eye evil because I'm good? So the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. For many be called, but few chosen. Praise the Lord. Ouch! Hallelujah. Amen. That's an insult to the ego. Yeah. The guy that's been living for God since 1950, yeah, and I come dragging in the 80s, and somebody else pops up in 2015 just before they drop dead,
yeah,
we're all getting the same thing.
Yes. Thank
you,
God. Yes.
Oh, Jesus. Praise the Lord. So you're telling me this horrible guy, like Hitler, you know, some despicable, awful person, can wait until they're on their deathbed to receive Christ and still receive the same benefit as Billy Graham? Yep. That's what I'm saying. I'm not advising you to wait for your deathbed because no man knows. But I'm just saying, the guy who accepts Christ, amen, and breathes his last breath, mm-hmm, is as saved as the most pious person that's walked this planet. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. And that's offensive to some, because grace offends human pride. Praise the God. So I'd say, get with the program and receive the free grace. Yes. And live your life, mm-hmm, free. Or be offended at the way God does things. Amen? But it won't bother God and it won't change his mind. This is the only way. It works. Praise the Lord. You see, look at it this way. There's sheep, and then there's goats, right? I'll show you some scripture later on. But there's sheep and there's goats. But there's no shoats, and there's no geeps, right? There's no third animal. There's either goats or sheep. It's that simple. Amen? There isn't a sheep-goat hybrid. Praise the Lord. So you're either getting an inheritance as a sheep, or you're getting hell as a goat.
Yes.
It's that simple.
It is.
That's the bottom line. Look at Matthew chapter 25. And let's look at verses 31 and 32. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations. That'll be us, that'll be sinners, that'll be believers and unbelievers. Before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats.
Yes, right.
We're not being judged, we're just being identified.
Exactly.
You're a sheep, you're a goat.
That's right.
You goat, and you goat.
Yep.
Amen?
Yes.
We're not geeps. We're not shoats. We're sheep, and he is our shepherd.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We know where we're going.
Exactly.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. All right. Look at Matthew. Let's look at, again here in Matthew 25, but verses 34. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Or verse 41, same chapter. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, unto everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. So here's the only options here are you get your inheritance or you get hell.
Exactly.
You're a sheep or you're a goat. By definition, the sheep get their inheritance.
Amen.
The goats, they go to hell.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. It's all or nothing. But still, there may be some people that think, well, they're going to get a huge payoff of heavenly loot when they get there. Amen? And I don't know where that comes from because it's not in the Bible. I don't even see the word rewards, plural, anywhere in the Scripture. Let's look at this, James chapter 1 and verse 12. So we've established that we're going to heaven, and we're going to heaven not based on anything we've done. Well, now, if we're not going to heaven based on anything we've done, why then are we thinking that we're going to get some kind of reward for what we've done? Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Okay, now everybody's thinking, I'm getting a crown. I'm just going to be going around heaven with my crown. Look here. Look what I did. We're all in heaven. But look, let's look at this. There's a crown of life for everybody who loves Jesus. But Jesus is life to us. Look at Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4. Right? It's the crown of life. Everybody gets one. But blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he's tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Okay, now look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 4. See what that crown is. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. He's not talking about a crown. He's talking about Christ.
Yes.
He is our life. The crown of life is Christ, our King, and we live his life. We have his life. He lives his life through us. Amen. We were crucified with Christ, and we now live. Yet it's not us that lives, but it's Christ that lives in us. Right? The life that I now live, Paul said, I live by the faith of the Son of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That's the crown, church. It's not a reward. We've already got it. The reward is Christ.
Yes.
Jesus. Amen?
Yes.
Now, there is a reward, singular, but everything else is done next to it because it's knowing Christ. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 14. If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. All right? So there is a reward, right? A singular. But look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. If any man works abide he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. Okay? Philippians now chapter 3, verse 8. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. Yes, my Lord, or Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ.
There is.
Praise the Lord. It's the knowledge of Jesus.
Yes.
Amen? It's your relationship with Jesus. Everything else is crap.
Yeah.
That's what Paul says.
Yep.
Amen? That's the reward.
Yes.
Jesus.
Yes.
Amen? Now, there's a prize mentioned, too. Philippians chapter 3, verse 14. I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's the prize, Christ Jesus. Amen? It's all Jesus. It's all grace. Somebody say amen. Somebody ought to say praise the Lord because you just got a pass. Hallelujah. You just got a pat on the head. God said everything's good. Amen. I'll see you in heaven for eternity.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, I'll be here to bless you and walk with you and lead and guide you into all truth. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And if you're looking for some kind of special reward, you know, I know heaven's going to be great. I just think we're way off track to think that we're getting a bunch of gold neck chains. Praise the Lord. Amen? Or having great mansions and looking at our neighbor's shack. Well, I'm counting my gold and notice you only had the one. It's really good. I've been really good. Got five chains. One? Well, praise the Lord. Glad you made it in. And I'm in my big mansion, and I'm looking down, and I'm thinking, gee, that's a shame. I don't think Roberto's even got electric this month. What's happening down there? I suppose I could invite him over for a snack or something. Got plenty of room here. Amen. Let's look at this. John chapter 14, verses 2 and 3. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Now, we know that this is like the Jewish marriage is a metaphor like for this. And what they would do is the fiancé, he would go and to his father's house and build a room on that house for his bride when they would marry. And at some unspecified day, he would go get her and bring her back to that room. That was now their place. It was in his father's house, but that room was theirs. So what he's talking about here is one big house, the father's house, but many rooms. He's prepared rooms for each of us, his bride, that he's going to come and get and bring back. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. It's a room. He's talking about, it's not really about my mansion versus your double wide.
Yeah.
Right? It's my room and your room. You got a room, I got a room. Everybody gets a room in the Father's house. Praise the Lord. It's about togetherness as the household of God. And that's why he says we are to love one another here on this earth. That's why we come together. That's why we give testimony. That's why we have prayer requests. That's why we give each other hugs. Why? Because we are a family.
Yes.
Amen. And we're going to our Father's house one of these days, and my room may be just down the hall from yours or across the hall. Amen. But it's not me in my big fancy thing and you in some little shack because I did more or you did more and I'm in the little dump. No, we all got rooms. He's preparing them for each one of us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and let's look at verse 14 first. We'll do 14 and 15. You can put them both up if you can, Sheila, either way. 1 Corinthians 3, 14 and 15. Okay, so if any man's work abide which he hath built thereon, he shall receive a reward. Okay, it sounds like we're talking about, we're back to this do stuff, right? And then it says, if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. So now what he's really talking about here is the reward. If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. What is the reward? It's Christ. And the work, the reward is basically seeing that what you've done by the Spirit, by the power of God, right, has lasted. Somebody got saved. Yeah. It's like Darlene and Suzanne. Now, Darlene could give millions to charities, right? She could find a cure for cancer. But that's all going to be gone, right? It's going to burn up. It's works. It's just things we did. It's not that they were bad things. They're just work. But Suzanne, she'll exist forever. That reward will go on forever because it was done by the Spirit.
Yes.
Suzanne came to the Lord as a result of her witness.
Right.
And the Holy Spirit draws people and you get the opportunity. That is something that goes on forever.
Yes.
And that's what he's talking about here. Amen? Yes. The loss is the loss of their work.
Right.
After all, it was burned up, right?
Because
it was all human effort. So it was time and energy that were wasted. Amen? That's the loss.
Right.
They're not losing rewards. They're just losing the time and the energy that they put into that. It doesn't have any permanent, eternal effect.
Right.
Amen? I mean, just think about it. Would you expect that works of the flesh would be preserved forever? No. What's eternal is eternal.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. That's the loss. It's the loss of the work itself. And that's different from God dishing out different amounts of cash prizes, amen, or perks and benefits because of something that you've done here on earth.
Right.
That's not grace. Grace means it's free, and it's the same for everybody.
Right.
Everybody gets the same benefit.
Right.
And it's Jesus.
Yeah.
Eternal life.
Right.
To know what is eternal life? To know God and Jesus Christ whom he hath sent.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. That's the package deal, folks. Amen. You're not going to get a Maserati or a Ford Escort. Praise the Lord. You're not getting gold chains and crowns and all this. You're getting Christ, eternal life. And everybody's getting it. Everybody that's born again is getting the same thing. And you're guaranteed to get it if you're a believer.
Yes.
So there is absolutely no... I mean, it would be counterintuitive to think that God would say, look, there is therefore no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, and then take you to heaven and give Roberto a 25,000 square foot building and gives me 180 efficiency. And I'm thinking, what's up with that? How'd that work? Or he's bopping down, you know, Heaven Boulevard, and he's got his crown and jewels, and he's so much gold on him, is pulling him down, and I'm bareheaded, amen, lucky to have a shirt on my back.
Yeah.
It's totally opposite. Am I going to be embarrassed? Of course I am.
Yeah.
Am I going to be humiliated? Absolutely. Yeah. There he goes. Mr. Special. Think there wouldn't be animosity?
Right.
No, that's why God said there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Everybody is equal in Jesus. Everybody gets the reward of everlasting righteousness and acceptance by God. That's how we can love one another. We can love each other right now. We're all the same.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Doesn't matter. You know, you may make a little more money. You may have this or that, but I'm saying, as far as God's concerned, we are identical twins. Praise the Lord. We're all the same. Hallelujah. And He loves us identically. Praise God. All right, Romans chapter 1, verse 16. We'll wrap up here pretty quick. Praise the Lord. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. What's the gospel of Christ? Grace. It's the gospel that Paul preached. That's what Paul said. He's preaching that gospel. And he said, I'm not afraid. I'm not ashamed of it. It's the power. It's the thing that's going to save you. Nothing else can save you. No works, no effort, nothing except for the works of Christ, the finished work of Jesus. Amen. He makes all things new. Hallelujah. So it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Everybody. To the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Amen? All right, now let's go to 2 Corinthians again, chapter 5, verse 19. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. He's reconciled us. Now He's saying, here's all I want you to do. Reconcile others. Tell them the good news. Tell them how much God loves them. Tell them God's paid the price. All they got to do is believe it. All they got to do is receive it. Praise the Lord. Amen. The new covenant offer is for everybody. Amen. I'm not saying everybody's saved, but I'm saying everybody got the same price paid so that they can be saved. All they got to do is respond to the offer of grace. That's what they need to know. They don't need to hear about, once you get this all straightened out and get that taken care of and then fix this thing up, come on around and see us. You know, then I think God may be able to work something out for you. No, God says, you freely you've received, freely give.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Amen? Jesus didn't come to you because you really put a lot of effort into getting Him to show up. Nobody comes to the Lord except the Spirit draws them. You know, you can't take any credit for any of it. So why shouldn't we be magnanimous? Why shouldn't we be generous? Why shouldn't we be loving to people that are struggling, the people that are, you know, caught up not in the world, in religion that has got them so freaked out and afraid that they can't meet all the requirements? When God said the only requirement is to believe in whom I have sent. Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, and you shall be saved.
That's right.
That's good news, church. Because
yes.
You can't screw it up.
That's right.
You can't foul it up. It's not about you. It's about Him.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen?
Yes.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. So, the new covenant is for everybody. Salvation is what God wants for every human being. Everybody. He wants everybody to be saved. So remember, the whole point of the gospel is that Jesus died, was punished in our place for everything that we've ever done or would ever do.
Yeah.
Now let's go back to Psalms 96, where we started, verses 1 and 2. So David had some insight. He was a man after God's own heart, and that wasn't because he was the best guy, because we know he was a foul-up. He made plenty of mistakes. And some of them weren't even mistakes. They were just bad choices. And yet God said he was a man after his heart. Why? Because David believed in the goodness and the mercy and the forgiveness of God. It's like he saw into another dispensation. Praise the Lord. He had a revelation of God. Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Show forth his salvation from day to day.
Yes.
How do you do that? By being happy. By having the joy of the Lord. By knowing that everything's good between you and God. It's attractive. People see it and they don't know what it is. They just know I want that.
Yes.
They may think you just got a pay raise when you might have just lost your job. They may think you hit the lotto. Amen. And you're trying to figure out how you're going to pay the house bill, the house rent. Amen. But you've got a promise from God. Just look, no matter how bad it gets, it's still really good. Praise the Lord. You still have the Lord. You still got an eternity that's paid for and purchased. You've got a room, a really nice room and a mansion waiting on you, and Jesus right there to greet you. Hallelujah. And in the meantime, even though you're going to have tribulations, he has overcome the world. You just got to stay focused on his love and his grace, and he'll make you victorious, and he'll make you a magnet. Hallelujah. Not a chick magnet, not a dude magnet, a sinner magnet, a magnet that will draw people to you so you can point them to Jesus. You can say, look, this is what God did for me. I was a mess. I had problems. I had issues. And God just showed himself mighty on my behalf.
Yes.
He loved me, and I believed when he told me that he loved me.
Yeah.
And he's been loving me and blessing me ever since.
Amen.
Praise God. So when it comes down to rewards, judgment, and punishment, you really can relax. You can chill out. You can take it easy. Rest in his finished work.
Yes.
It is finished.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You're perfect in love. In the Father's love. And you're in the family of God.
Yes.
And it doesn't get any better than that.
Right.
I think we ought to just thank the Lord right now. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. No excuse to not be happy. Happiness and sadness, I mean, I understand that. But the joy of the Lord is your strength. When the enemy comes with his lies about you haven't done enough, or you messed that up, or you shouldn't have felt that way or thought that, you need to remind him that he's the liar and that you are secure in the love of God.
Right.
Amen. And if you're fearful, you just need a bigger dose of that love to perfect you in Christ. That's the only thing you're lacking, is your awareness of how much God loves you and what he's done for you. Amen. God bless all of you. Have a great week. Enjoy the Lord. Enjoy your destiny. It's a good one. Praise the Lord. Amen. Enjoy it. God bless you. You're dismissed in the mighty and the matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus. God bless you. Have a great week. Shake hands with our visitors. Tell them we really appreciate them being here.